Hello everybody. So happy to see so many people for a sunny Sunday. We will have a talk with Vitek, but before I will just show you and present you in 15-20 minutes the genesis and the project in general. Before this, at last moment, happy birthday Lars again. It was really important in this project, you will know why. So this will be the presentation of the book, like in the exhibition. That's the second time I'm showing the book on the wall. The first time it was with Iris Seeking at the FOMU. It was a mix between fine art print and the book. But with Lars we were talking a lot about this Krakow exhibition, and we decided to go in a row exhibition. We will talk a little bit later. But for me, I'm at first a photographer who likes to do books, and second, of course, if I can do exhibition, it's a pleasure too. But all my projects are made at first for books. I'm using a lot of content inside, text, music, like you can listen behind. So from the beginning, I know more or less the size of the book, what I want to, who I want to be invited in the book. So you can see here, the cover is just keywords from A to Z. That's the inside. You will see that we have a white and pink page. The white is the photographic part with captions. The pink is more the skin tones. And you will see that all the book is encode and decode. We decide to put all the material in the same level. Now the book, the project. Before to be a photographer, I was a gardener, working in gardens, drawing gardens for... Sorry. Music. I was gardener, drawing gardens for clients, rich clients most of the time. And after 15 years I stopped. I was traveling a lot for humanitarian NGOs, not photographer but educator. And my first photographic project was in East Europe. It was a project about the European border. So I was crossing Poland in 2001. And I was shooting with another photographer. The idea was to see and try to understand why Europe stopped at one limit. And where is the limit and what is the border? A border can be a wall, like we saw in the past, or it's again another perspective in some countries. The European border is like a filter. So we spent 8 years working on this project. You can see the book in the exhibition space. And we were yet at this moment where we invite 10 writers, a rock band from France, and some movie writers and some screen from movies. And from this moment in 2009, after this project of Europe, I was curious to follow in this question, what is Europe? How we see and we want to build this Europe? And like Gardner, I saw in newspaper this first question about seed bank in Svalbard, in the Spitzberg. So I was asking Lars, because he was working for Do magazine. Do magazine is a famous beautiful art magazine in Switzerland. And I was asking Le Monde in Paris to accept and give me the opportunity to go to this seed bank. So I was shooting 4 or 5 days back, we published. And from this moment, for me, it was not only an assignment, so a small project, it was a, a long-term project. So from this moment, I spent a lot of time reading, research, trying to contact most of the people, and like you can imagine, it's really, really complicated to have access to those places. So I'm always telling that I spend more 80% behind my desk and 10 or 15% shooting. So because the project is so huge, I decide to build four chapters, like you can see. First, plants, second, animals, third one, humans, and the last one, the data. Most of the time people ask me why data, because the three first chapters are organic material and the last one is digital, but you will understand, or I hope understand why. So Lars Friedemeyer built a huge glossary. I was inviting Lars, he was close to the project from the beginning, but at one moment I was drawing keywords for me, just to have a line for the photographic part, and sharing information and showing the picture to Lars, we decide to build this glossary. So together we choose 35 keywords, and I let Lars free to build this glossary. And looking at the result, I was really happy at first, and second, it was an important, really important piece. So for me, it was not a text to put at the beginning or the end of the book. It was just an idea to try to put the text in the sequence. So we are from A to Z, and the photography flowing in the middle too. After, we have Thomas Lemke with this question, what was life? What was life? A crazy, strong questions. You can see in the exhibition that we have a website. You can, and we invite you to answer to these questions. It's of course a big curiosity for us to know what you feel about this. And if it's working well, maybe in the future I can add all those answers in a smaller booklet to give with the book. And the last is Jacques Arnoult. Jacques Arnoult is a scientist, ethician for the space, for the French NASA. And he was a monk, and he was an engineer in agriculture. So when I met this man the first time, we spent hours to talk, and I was so happy to have him in the book. 2 weeks later, well, 2 weeks ago, I was in Brittany on a talk with him, and it was really interesting. It's in French, but you can see it on YouTube. Okay, the photographic part. From the beginning, I was curious to shoot only inside, but here you see a classic landscape. The question of banks. We are in Europe in big crisis, crisis with the public government, with the institutions, with the economy too. We have, of course, this climate change crisis with ecology. So the emergency or the risk puts some scientists and some governments to have the idea to put every genetical patrimony in banks. So some scientists are really against, for a question like Darwin was telling, evolution. So the people, the seeds and the animals need to live in their own land and field, like the in situ conservation. And the other, the more easy and the more the more emergency, is to put in ex situ, so in banks. The most famous is Svalbard, this on this island, the Svalbard Global Seed Vault. It's a public and private seed bank. The idea is that every government will send a duplicate of their own crop seeds to this place. Why Norway and why this island? Because they think that this place will never have a war or nuclear attack or explosion. And they think that in this deep bunker, in the permafrost, you can conserve seeds for years, 100 years. I was curious because this bank have two names, the classic one, the Svalbard Global Seed Vault, and another nickname, it's the Domfday Vault or the Noé Ark. So, because we will talk about the post-colonization, you will see that we talk a lot about the Bible in this book. I'm not religious, but I was surprised that we use a lot of keywords like Genesis, Apocalypse, Ashes to Ashes, and other ones. So this is the only landscape, and from this moment we go deep in bunkers, cave boxes, really close area, close to public, close to everybody most of the time. Only scientists and photographers can enter this place. Here, the introduction of the text, and you will see each time we have two white page, two pink page. The second picture, and after I will go quickly, I think it's a good example. Vavilov Institute, one of the biggest seed vaults in Russia, St. Petersburg. Vladimir Putin wants to close this seed bank because he needs the field close to the airport to give the field to the France to build new buildings for real estate. So going deep in this seed bank, I discovered that Vavilov died in a gulag by Stalin. So from a guy who made one of the biggest seed bank, it's a little bit strange how he died. And second, during the Leningrad war, 28 scientists decide to close the door and live in this seed bank to conserve and save those seeds. But they die because they were not eating, but they had thousands of food. But to save those seeds, they decide to lose their life. So you can see that for some people, it's a really important material. For others, it's a private and economic possibility to make money. And for scientists, it's part of a patrimony. And for some public, other people, it's pure romantic or pure fear. So I will go a little bit quickly and after we talk together. This is the biggest banana seed bank is in Belgium. It's a post-colonization. So if African government need a banana, they need to ask the Belgian. Svalbard. That's one of the iconic picture each photographer going in this bank is shooting this frozen door. This is a banana in vitro. I will go to the animal part. Each chapter of the book ends with this huge big walls in the classic exhibitions or in museum exhibitions. This print is like 1.90 meter by 1.10 meter. So I was curious to have this confrontation with the public with a huge print. The other prints are like 70 centimeters and still life 42. Here, for example, I was surprised that for animals it's the same issue. We are conserving biopsy, blood, sperm, and a huge business is behind because if you do a classic reproduction between horses or with a bull, you can have one or two baby, but if you select and control the sperm, you can produce until 65 animals. So private companies are going deep in this market. And just to remember, if you listen a few years ago about Henry Kissinger, one of the main American friend to George Bush and others, he was telling that if you control oil, you control a country. But now, if you control food and water, for example, you control everything. So the next market, and it's not from today, it's from 30, 40 years ago, and maybe from the colonization. If you control the food and the water, you will be the next boss controlling everything, and the data too. So this is a normal new reproduction between a fake female and a horse. This is sperm in a child bottle. I like this picture because you have the dinosaur and you have the cloud, and we are more and more talking about the cloud. You know, everybody is concerned the data and clouds. We use this word like every day, and my new project in the catalog, you will see that I'm working about air pollution and clouds. This is a biopsy from a Malaysian bear. So zoo are a new type of conservation to ex situ conservation. So now the zoo are conserving biopsies, sperm and blood, and they are sharing to others. If one day we will have an extinct animal, maybe with DNA and genetics and clonage, we will have a new mammoth or elephant or lions. That's a good question for society to think, because we are entering in this Anthropocene, so the human being is controlling everything. What do you want if we are losing a lion? You want to have a memory of a lion, or you want a new lion made by clonage? And I think it's a question of society, it's not a question only for scientists or businessmen behind. And I'm always surprised, because the biotechnology, the genetic, the science is growing so fast those days, that the juridic, the law, the politics, they are just running behind, that they don't understand nothing, and the public, they don't know. So I think at one moment we will need to sit and talk really about the future of all this. Who will own this patrimony? What we will do with this patrimony? What we want, like a future? This is the Malaysian bear. Darwin, quite important with the tree of life, is still really important for scientists. This is a Japanese snail who exists only in one mountain, but nobody cares because it's a snail. You know, it's more easy to take care of a dolphin or beautiful animals. Japanese snails, you can see that it's a data deficient, so nobody's taking care of studying this. You need to imagine that the scientists now, with the European or the Occidental crisis, they need to reach money. So to reach money, you need to have a topic, and a great topic. And the topic, if you think about and you want to study about climate change, you will raise funds. If you talk, for example, about insignificant animals who nobody cares, you will not have money. So it's a deal too. The scientists are playing the game about the money. This is a reproduction of two bulls, because the cow are not allowed in this place for sanitary reasons. So this is one of the biggest bull sperm bank in France. They are producing thousands of sperm straw every day. And this bull will give sperm to the other, and after they change the position, and you will see later that this is the new type of laboratory. So in one side you have the study, and the other side you have the pure reproduction. In the exhibition you have a huge poster. The poster is Yoko Bestman. So I just stole this advertising from the company. They are so proud because this bull made 350,000 cow. He never saw one because he never saw a cow. Never saw the baby too. And now he died in 2012. And he will be in a representation in a museum in Paris, like a reference for the best bull ever. And he made 1.7 million sperm sold to 2,389 farmers worldwide. This is Niels. Okay. Lions. This is a conservation of lion's blood in UK. Frozen Ark. Again, a nickname about the Bible. I met this old lady, really rich, who is she's taking care to conserve all the maximum of endangered or extinct animal in a small tank. Now we conserve all this material in nitrogen liquid, so it's easy. You have a tank, you put nitrogen liquid inside, and after you put your sample. Again, we don't know how many time we can conserve, and if one day in 200 years you want to reproduce a lion, if he'll live and born. We don't know if he can live in this society because he stopped the evolution for 200 years. So that's a huge and huge question. Last picture again, a wall. Lenin mausoleum on the Red Square of Moscow. When Lenin died in 24, they cut his brain in 30,000 slides because they were thinking it was a genius, and they create the Institute of the Lenin, the Genius of Lenin. You will see later that now on cryo conservation in Russia, they are specialized to conserve the human body or brain from bodies. We talk about transhumanism. It's Russia, it's not working. But don't forget that Google is spending billions every year doing research about transhumanism. Transhumanism is the idea that it's like science fiction, or it was like science fiction, because now it's close to be real. It's the idea that maybe the human being can live until 120 or 150 years at the end of this century. We are thinking about exoskeletons, like, you know, for military reason you can carry 200, 300 kilos, fake legs. Now people in the United States are asking to cut the legs, to have artificial legs, because you are 30-40% more efficient. So all these SIM cards behind your skin, or the remote access to your iPhone directly in your skin, all this crazy things, but it looked like people are really curious. This type of conservation of stem cells, umbilical cords and stem cells in Switzerland. You know Switzerland for black money and secret bank accounts, but now we are beginning to be a huge data center place and a huge stem cell place. Why? Because, like example, in Italy or in France, they are Catholic and the government don't allow to people to conserve their own samples, because the idea of the religion is to share your material to others, so you give to a public hospital. But life is changing, society is changing, religion is changing, so the people are moving from Italy and France, and they are conserving their samples, blood, sperm and stem cells in Switzerland. And because we have this tradition of security, of silence and of a black and corruption system, it's a good place to begin a new business. This is a conservation of body in ice in north of Moscow, 80 kilometers north of Moscow. Those bodies are waiting for cryo conservation. Milk teeth, you can conserve milk teeth from your children for stem cells. This is the idea of conservation of human body, and they are trying to have a transparent one, like the family can visit the body, the dead body. Stem cells conservation in Switzerland. Fyodorov, one of the main important guy about transhumanism. Oh, a tank with 4 heads and 1 dog in conservation. This is a sperm straw. In Denmark, Iris, we have one of the biggest sperm bank where you can choose between anonymous donor or non-anonymous donor. So you can buy sperm on internet and you can use the keywords like I want a baby with blue eyes, 1.90 meter, black hair, speaking 4 languages and doing bicycle and eating only vegan. And the website give you an idea and match the answer, and after you pay with your Visa card and you can have access by DHL or FedEx in your house. It looks strange, but 52% of the clients are women alone from 35 to 45 years old, really well educated, who want to do a baby alone. 15% they are lesbian, who can't have a baby without this type. And the other percent are families who have problems to have children. So the classic sperm bank. I was talking with the owner and I was talking about eugenism, the question about, you know, can be a problem if you select everything and what will happen in the society if we try to control even the birth and the baby. And he told me, oh, it's not a problem. It's not a private problem. It's a social society problem. But every woman choose their own father or so. You see, the line between juridical, law, ethic, it will be a main problem. Data center, that's a Switzerland one. Like I was telling, Switzerland have 26,000 bunkers from the Cold War and the Second War. But like you know, Switzerland was never in war for several reasons. Now this bunker, for example, it was a military one for airplanes, and now a private company just bought this bunker for 40 million Swiss francs, it's 40 million euro, and they have one of the biggest and safe data center worldwide. The nickname is Swiss Fort Knox, regarding the Fort Knox in US. The airport was a military one, and now it's an international one, so you can land with your own plane, put your black box, your data, and your server inside, close the door, and go back to Singapore, to Qatar, to London, or to Krakow. This is the entrance. It's for the rockets. You can't shoot with big guns inside because the corridor is like a snake, so you can protect yourself. This is in Stockholm. Inside you have the WikiLeaks data. Not only here, of course, they share the data in several data centers to be safe. This data center is just built down a Catholic church, the St. Sophia in Stockholm. This is the example with rocks and data. They were really proud to have WikiLeaks inside, but some clients left because they were afraid about deep attack because they own or they conserve WikiLeaks. At the beginning of this work, we were talking of WikiLeaks, but not about Snowden and Prism and NSA. So for me, at the beginning, it was easy to have access to data. At one moment, every door were closed. Nobody was curious to talk again. And with the Patriot Act, you know, that George Bush signed just after the Twin Towers fall, the US government can have access to your all your data. So now the US companies are leaving the United States and they are curious to come in Europe to conserve their own data. And Switzerland is a good place for this. That's the two blue lights, they are the WikiLeaks data. You can see the video, you know this video about the helicopter shooting on citizens. We saw this video and I think most of the clients and the people, they just learned with WikiLeaks that your data are so important. If you lost or somebody stole your data, you are losing all your archive, but you are losing all your secrets and all the sensitive material. Classic data center. That's the Yoko Bessner advertising. And maybe the last picture here. This is an empty tube. It's a 4 centimeter tube. And inside, you have all the Shakespeare sonnets. 159 sonnets. You have the speech of Martin Luther King, the song you were listening before. You have one picture and you have one text from Watson and Crick, the two guys who discovered DNA in 1956. But you see nothing because all those data information are encoding in DNA. That's the new way of storage in the future. So it's a laboratory in the UK, in ABI, who creates the solution that's with the 4 letters of DNA and the two numbers of the digital 01 with the new system of scissor to cut ADN, DNA and to re-glue. You can conserve for long, long term in a small tube like this. 1 million CD. So they were telling me that all internet can be conserved in a sneaker chocolate bar, you know. So because the data center now, they are using 2 or 3% of electricity and it's not safe, it's really hot and it's a huge material. We are trying and running after solution to conserve for long term. So you can see that synthetic biology and a new way of thinking about DNA can be a solution in the future. And I was really happy, but that's one of the last pictures I was shooting. So this picture for me linked to everything. And if you read the text from Thomas Lemke, he's talking about post-biology, and we are not anymore in biology like we were looking. Now we conserve DNA, we conserve data. So from a seed, from a sperm, from human or a bull, or for your Facebook picture, for most of the scientists and the economic business is the same data. So now we will share some talk, and if you have any question in the future, please.
Thank you very much. Well, can you go back to this picture of DNA data encoded? So the first question I'd like to ask is it concerns this image, in fact, because this is an example of combining something organic with data, and in the book and in the whole project, you use this very visible division between plants, animals, humans, and data. On the other hand, among the texts in the glossary and in the book, there are suggestions that now we live in the times when such divisions are not so obvious. And how do you think now about this strong division between human, plants, animals, and data? Does it? Did you change your mind about it during the project?
Well, yes, of course, I learned a lot. If I begin the book with plants, because it's the more romantic, you know, when you are children at school, you learn how to grow seeds and you take some leaves from the tree and you put in the book to dry, and after you have your beautiful tree, a beautiful leaf. So it's romantic. We are all close to a grandmother or grandfather who was a farmer, all deep in, you know, in gardening and everything. After animals, of course, we're still in the farm, but it's a new farm, new business. Human, that's the sensitive part. Most of the time in conference, or I talk because, or in exhibition, because touch directly to you. And data is new. It's so new that nobody cares about Facebook, Google, everything. You know, we are putting everyday picture, we are sharing on Gmail or Amazon, we are buying stuff. And nobody cares about those big data. Big data is a big name, nobody understands. But I just read last week that Amazon, Google, Facebook and Apple, they are reaching $800 billion each year regarding the big data. So it's a big market, and it's only growing. To come back to your question, I think the society and the citizens and people like you and me, we still look at plants, animals, and humans. But until when? I don't know. Scientists are not surprised about this, you know. And we with Lars and Aga, we were trying to translate all those data, so captions. It was made from 2009 to 2014, and most of the numbers, they are not anymore true.
They're not valid.
Because it's, yeah, not, not, not. It's growing so fast. So this book for scientific approach is out. For photographic reason, it's okay, but in 5 years, maybe people will look, telling, it looked like the 80s, you know, in a sense, because it's growing so fast. So I don't have an answer to your question, but I hope I will stay regarding plants, animals, and humans.
That's in this way. Okay, and now the, I think the biggest question I have, and most general, I guess. For the yeah, I wanted to ask, because photographing an archive or archives is kind of very difficult subject, because, and it's a great example, an image of a book. When you photograph a cover of a book, and you show and say this is this book, you do not in fact show what's inside the book or the content. And this is the question that was coming back to me. Somehow, why did you decide to do this project? I mean, was your intention mainly to shed light on the subject, or to learn something on your own, or to investigate something, or to share some kind of feelings that we might have towards this the positioning of things?
I think at first it's egoist, because it's a question that touches you, so you say, and I think like artist or photographer, we need to be touched by the subject before. And after, we are happy if the public is touched. But at first it's a personal question. And with the European border, when I was shooting this border, we had those two keywords, fear and control. And Europe, for me, I was dreaming about Europe. I was voting yes when I was in Switzerland, and the majority vote no, so we are not in Europe. But I was dreaming about this idea. And when I saw this, for me it was the following of fear and control. So, of course, I'm a gardener, so seeds, my grandfather was a farmer, animals, it's okay. I know botanic, I can know the Latin name of the plants, not all, but a small part. So I was touched, and after, of course, I was thinking it's a huge society question, and this book don't give an answer, and that was not the idea. Because I learn a lot from scientists, I learn a lot shooting picture and writing all those codes and captions. So the project changed a lot in 5 years. This this picture I was not expecting. We were preparing the first show, so and the book was close to be ready, and I saw this in newspaper, so I flew to UK just to shoot one picture. Yeah, I think if photography can give a huge question to the audience, I think it's a one good point.
Okay, and yeah, so and the next thing is a question of sticking to the photographic level, because when I was reading the book and watching those images, I started thinking, you used photographic medium to do it. You didn't write a book, you didn't make a film, you decided to use a photographic medium. And do you see any connection? Because for me, for example, the connection is really strong between, because this book is somehow about preservation, and photography is somehow about preservation, as we all know. So do you see this connection of the medium you're using with the subject of freezing time and like you do in photography and keeping it for later to look at it later. So did you think about the connection with the medium of photography while doing it?
Yeah, of course. And I'm still shooting in analogy, so it's another type of conservation. Yeah, and it was good with the scientists because they never saw the picture. You know, with digital background, they are always behind you, looking at the picture. Yes, of course. Photography can stop for one moment something. In this project, for me, the most important it was the thing in between, because I'm not, like you say, I'm not showing the huge place where they store everything. I take some piece, like extractions, ex situ presentation with this black background. So for me it was an example of ex situ, and I'm showing doors or walls. So I let the people imagine in between, because it's not like a photo reportage showing exactly. And for me, with those keywords that we were drawing with Lars, the idea is sociology, philosophical, science fiction too, because some people, they tell me it's not true, it's a mise-en-scène, it's a fake. And I say, no, sorry, you know, when you read the captions, it's true. After, I like the relation between the photography and the text. It's old, you know, the caption from the beginning of photography, you put the captions. But the caption, most of the time, they are in two parts. You have the two first line, like a classic caption, and after you have quotes from magazine or quotes from books, scientist books, or interview I made by iPhone, and after you rewrite. So yeah, but photography for me most of the time, it's a tool. I'm not a huge photographer in the sense, you know, working a lot about photography. For me it's a tool. I love sequence, I love to build this, and this time for me the challenge before the first picture, it was the confrontation between captions and picture. And for most of the photographer, it's a nightmare. Do you put information, how much information in exhibition? What do you do in books? It's what, at the end, or it's just captions and picture? So it was a nightmare too for me, but after, when I decide that it will be captions and picture, sometimes, for example, the caption is bigger than the picture. Sorry, too fast. Yeah. So the balance, and I like this idea that sometimes the picture say nothing or not so much, can be look like a pure aesthetical picture or just you know. And you read and you have the solution or a confrontation or sometimes an abstraction in between. So yeah, that's the idea of several layers in the book, even the music.
Yeah, and what also struck me is that you decide not to use photography in the very very straightforward documentary way, in the sense of using it as if it was transparent, just to show the thing. But you break the transparency because you use the darkness, the black. And yeah, why does this? It's a stupid question to ask.
No, it's not.
Why did you decide to make it dark? Why did you do so?
For several reasons. At first, I think we have a really dark idea of the future. Regarding what the people talk, I remember when I was a student in Garden, my teacher was telling me that during the colonization, when the rich colonizer came back, they built garden, and the title of the garden was the Eden Garden, you know, in the positive way. Now we are talking about apocalypse fault. So in 5-6 centuries, we changed our lecture of nature about knowledge, the rich, what's the value of the things. So second, I'm overexposed, you know, I'm really dark, but I saw that most of those places, they turn off the light. You know, it's just a garage, it's just a bunker where you store, like your freezer. Yeah, you open, you have the vegetables, you close the door, the light is closed. So they were always turning on lights to show me, and I was telling, but in general, how it is in this room? They say, oh, we turn off the light, nobody's coming. So I say, let's try without light. So it was a 10-15 minutes exposure, so a long time. But I tried to give this atmosphere of, you know, it's just a back door, you know, like a cave.
And would you move to more general issues? Would you consider the project being somehow, again, as with your previous project, about fear? And I think fear in the sense of, because what's striking me when I read and look at those pictures is that behind each of this deposit, there is an idea of what might happen to our civilization to make us need it. So there's this huge unspoken fear that's covering all of it. And do you think this is, you're working with aspects of fear in your previous and this project?
No, I try to show the fear, and I'm really afraid about the fear, you know, regarding the extreme right growing in Europe, the fear about the migrants, the fear about the future, the fear about the present. And people, when they have fear, they vote badly, or they think badly, or they are aggressive, or they lost their nerves. So I'm just putting the finger on some, I'm trying big questions, and I try to be not neutral and objectivity, because we don't care about this, but trying with sometimes beautiful landscape in the European border is just a really white, snow, beautiful landscape, like romantic, but you are exactly on the border between Poland and Russia, or Estonia and Russia, and that's the border. So trying with some fragile and sensitive picture to give this idea, and to give the soap bubble to the people. And that's always difficult, I think, for a documentary photographer, where you stop to give information. If you give too much, it begins to be really didactic. Like if you read how to build your robot for cooking, you know. And the other one can be too much abstract. So it's why the layers of lecture need to be for not thinking to everybody, but trying to give a sense of first level to the really deep sense. And like I was telling, for me it's a question. So fear it's different for everybody, but when we are living in society and you can feel that it's a huge fear, until that economy and public companies are playing with this or trying to store material, because this for animals and seeds, for example, we stole from the poor country in Europe, you know, and it's why in a sense we are rich too, because we stole from the colonization. And now we have new emerging countries, European crisis. So with this idea that we stole everything, it's more easy to understand that somebody can stole our material too, because we made it. So the fear is this too, you know? And the value, we understand. We understand the value of a seed, because for people it's romantic, telling, oh, we lost trees and flowers. But for scientists it's like, we are using this to build a business. And strange is that behind the biggest seed bank, it's Monsanto, Syngenta and other big company, they have the responsibility of the losing of the biodiversity because they are selling monoculture to the farmers. So in a sense, the last 70 years, they built this crisis and now they store all this material, thinking that in the future, they will own this and can sell some new material. For example, the banana we are eating every day, now she's really sick, the Cavendish, the banana you can eat in the supermarket. So we will need a new one for 25 years. And who is the owner? The Catholic University of Leuven in Belgium.
So it's also kind of capitalizing the fear.
Of course, of course. But we see this in media, we see this on TV, we see this in everything. That's a good market.
Yeah, I think that this relation between sharing information about fear and that cause fear, and in your project, and the relation of using the imaging tools to share emotions of the fear, or I would say melancholia, maybe when I look at the project, they become really visible. When you decide, compare the form of the book, when you have the text and so on, when you confront it with the slideshow and music, if we could play it now,
yeah.
Because I think it's from informative project here, it's somehow becoming really strong emotional thing, touching the subject of fear in the sense of an emotion. And I wanted to ask you, two questions. One is about the music, if you could elaborate on the music. And you said it at the opening, but maybe not everyone were there. And the second question is somehow connected with it. Can you say something about the difference in working on this project in the sense of a book and in the sense of an exhibition? How do you feel the difference between those two types of work with the same, let's say, material?
First, about music, like I was telling yesterday, I'm a little bit monomaniac. Each project I choose one CD and I use this CD like a sound to help me to be concentrated on my topic. On the first, on the European border, it was a French group, and with this one it was Benfrost, and I know Benfrost for a long time, and he called me one night telling I need some picture in Berlin. My new parent, so I went there shooting picture and we were talking about this topic, and he was curious about the science fiction behind. He's working for games and working for a TV show now, a TV series, and we had a deal, no bill for the picture for him, and he wrote a piece of music for me. But I decide with Ben first and like with the other contributors that most of the time I finish the work and I give all this material, like the raw base material, and they do what they want. They can write, a piece of fiction, a scientist truly text. And I was talking about synthetic biology with Ben Frost, so he decided to use only synthetic voice. So you can listen some people singing, but it's fake voice, like a Siri voice when you write your text. For me, the book, that's the best way regarding the content. I like the intimacy of the book, the democratic point of view of a book. It's 30 euro. You can read it when you want, you can share it, you can sleep on it, you can decide to read only 3 pages or don't read the text, just look at the picture. In exhibition, it's difficult to show everything. At the first show in Photomuseum Winterthur, I was talking with Thomas Selig and he told me, you know, the statistic of the museum is the visit is 15 minutes. So I was like, what? In 15 minutes, how to give information to somebody, you know, with all those codes and all those texts? So we decided just to show the prints and to print a small booklet, free, that the people can bring back home or read in the bus or give to others. Here it's different because we are showing the books and that's the first time I'm showing picture with music in this black box. And I will tell you something is that until a few months ago I was really against this and I was fighting against because I was thinking that music change, sometimes the music begin to be more important than picture or the other side, or the meaning will change if you have music with text. Here, it's different because the picture don't say so much and the music don't say so much because we don't have text. But on the first book, the text of the music was really important. So sometimes the text was changing the meaning of the picture. So it's, for me, it's always sensitive, but with Lars, we try, and I'm really happy with this black box, but that was my fragile position for this show a few weeks ago.
And do you see any difference in how the images work in this context and in the book context?
In slideshow with music?
Yeah.
Yes, of course. Of course. And even more because this book is just with the text, it's not a pure sequence of a classic photo book. You have space in between and the space is full of text and the text is really important. You know, it's not a text like an introduction from a curator or a friend writing something. It's really all the content. So all those layers. But I'm surprised because we changed the color of the page. Some people told me, oh, sometimes I just turn only the white page and I'm looking at only like a classic book. And sometimes I decide just to read the text like a literary book. So with this difference of color, it's because it's really encoded, it's like two books in one.
Okay, and so I think we should open up the discussion. But yeah, I wanted to ask one last, I guess, pretty stupid question. But among those four parts, like plants, animals, humans, and data, do you have your favorite one? I mean, the one that you feel most interested in, is it maybe plants?
No, I think more and more they are all connected. Of course, plants, but no. I begin with plants because it was more easy for me. You know, it was more easy to shoot and that was the first idea. But To tell you the truth, at the beginning, I was curious to shoot classic paints with gold, or even in Switzerland we have art in safe deposit box from the Jewish and the Nazi war, and we have cocaine in, you know, everybody can conserve what they want in banks. The religion, they have deep collection, you know, from old writers, from iconic material, from bones. So at the beginning I was writing a project so huge that I need real life and a lot amount of money to and nerves to organize this. So at the end I chose those four chapters. And it was 4 years and 21 plays, so it was quite a lot too. But now it's, for me, all is really linked. Some people, they say, yes, I prefer the plants picture because, you know, they feel more, yeah, it's more easy. Some are crazy about the data because they love digitals and they love this idea of WikiLeaks and Snowden. The human is the more sensitive.
The last one. When you decided to remove, was it from the beginning, since the beginning of the project, or it came to you later, to decide to remove the scientists almost? I mean, there are three images, I guess, with people in it.
The first 6 months I was shooting portraits.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask.
But at one moment, because in the captions I just began to understand that some scientists are against this or for this, economic, public and private, I was curious to erase humans on picture, to have really a human question. And if you begin to identify humans, you will say, this is a bad guy, this is a good guy, oh, I'm close to this guy, or I'm really against this guy. So erase the human in this type of project and you really touch the human, because it begins to be a question for each one. You open the book and the book gives you the question. It's, you don't have another protagonist in the middle telling, oh, this guy have the responsibility. We have all, you know, we are deep in this every day.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Any more questions?
Yes, feel free to ask questions. Just raise the hand, please.
I'd like to ask whether you're interested in conserving the idea of the separate elements, whether you would like us to still continue classifying plants, humans, animals, and data separately, or whether you're working to educate new way of thinking and the merging of these different things?
Like I was telling, for me, sadly, like most of the people, I don't have an answer to those questions. The good point with this is that at the first show, for example, in Vientato, we were surprised because we had farmers coming to the show. We had school and I had doctors, and we made meetings and talks, sharing questions about the conservation of the stem cells or privatization of the cells from humans. So I'm really happy about the curiosity of the people, but like everybody, we don't have so much answer. 2 weeks ago, with another conference, people were asking what can we do, and one of the geneticians was telling maybe the only solution is to go to vote and to work with NGOs in the direction you like. If you want to work against the data system, or you want to save plants, I think for me, more and more I'm thinking that the citizens need to really do something and not waiting for the politics or the economy. And voting is not enough now. We need to be in solidarity and talking like this and doing something. Of course, photography is nothing. It's just, you know, sharing information. And I don't think I will change something with this book, but yeah, I changed a little bit my way of eating, and I have a huge garden now, and I'm doing my own garden, and I'm buying some meat that I know the producer, and for a computer I'm really bad, so my data are, like everybody, lost in this cloud. I don't know if I answered your question.
Thank you very much.
Get a quick question about some kind of like technological background, because have you been allowed to take out samples out of these places, and if not, how did you achieve this like perfect black background on pictures? Because it's I imagine it was quite problematic. I mean, did you arrange some kind of miniature photo studio there or something like that?
I'm shooting without flash because I'm always using natural light. I don't know if I was telling this, but most of the time, if they agree to come inside the bunker, they think like in 10 or 15 minutes you have enough to shoot. So you are always fighting to have more, 1 hour or 2 hours. And most of the time they say, no, no, come with your digital camera, shoot some picture and go back. So I was traveling really light with 1 minute format, some films, a tripod. And the tool I learned quickly is that ask for a lot amount of sample, like they need like 1 hour to find everything. And during this time you shoot the architecture and the doors and at the end you just use 1 or 2 sample and you say thank you and you had your hour. So I learned quickly. But I never take sample outside at first because they are defrozen, so you need to be fast. And they are sample with, you know, organic stuff, so I was not curious to kill some material just for a beautiful picture. And I used just a black tissue, 2 meter by 2 meter, with tape, and you found, you know, a source of light, can be artificial or a window, and you shoot. But that's a good tool to ask a lot of sample. Like they are running everywhere, you have nobody around you, so you are free to do your picture. And it's of course really too expensive, but maybe one day a collection guy will come and say I have 50,000 Swiss francs and let's put the book in the tube. But you know, maybe in 10 or 20 years we will have all a DNA card in our pocket and with all our data, so books too.
Last chance.
Thank you.